Hey everybody, I hope you're having a great Monday. I wanted to start out the Advent season by talking about how you would apply the principles of Advent to your entire life this Christmas season. And it isn't just about Christmas in the sense that we think about all the trappings of Christmas and the presents and the hustle and the bustle. Advent is a season of preparing our hearts for something that we deeply need. So, for those of you who are feeling a little grinchy, Advent may be really geared more for what you need than you think. In fact, Christ came at one of the darkest periods in Israel's history. People were not in a celebratory mood when Jesus arrived on the earth. In fact, the Old Testament prophets predicted it would be the darkest moment in the history of God's people when the Savior arrived to brighten the world. And they didn't even know that this hope had come at the time. In fact, they were only aware of the tremendous tragedy and the oppression and the poverty that they were experiencing. You see, Israel was enslaved by a foreign country, a pagan country that they disagreed with. So if you're at odds with the people who are in authority over you or in your government right now, you may be able to commiserate with where the people were when Jesus arrived. And if you're mourning, consider this: King Herod killed all the infants 2 years old and younger because he was so fearful of the prophecy of this king to come and replace him. So there was mass mourning going on for people whose babies were snatched from their hands, whose toddlers were snatched from their hands and slaughtered right in front of their eyes. This was a horrific moment for those who were surrounding the birth of Jesus Christ. In fact, Jesus came at this dark, dark time to deliver us from the darkness, the deepest darkest. And he came into a situation himself in his own family. They had no place to stay. They were in sort of stable conditions, probably a cave. Modern historians believe it was probably a cave. In fact, I did read something that showed that one of the scribes that translated the early scriptures into Latin for the first time did so in the cave that was believed to be the cave where Jesus was born. So if you can imagine sitting in that cave for years translating scripture into Latin, which was the common tongue of written language at the time. So this was all about places of darkness, of cold, of discomfort when Christ came to rescue us with the first thing we're going to talk about is peace. This week, I want to focus on the first week of Advent, and that is peace. How do we illuminate our dark lives with the peace that only God can give us? This is the peace, as Scripture says, that passes understanding. It's not a peace we would expect at this moment in our lives. It's not a peace that we even think is possible because it's only a sort of peace that we can get from God. It's an impossible by human standards peace, a divine peace, and only Christ can bring this peace to our lives. There are tangible, physical, practical ways that we can apply the peace of Advent to the rest of our lives, not just our religious part of our lives, but the rest of our lives, which should all be spiritual in some degree, in some nature, because we are not compartmentalized people. We are who we are throughout all of our lives. So we don't just take one piece of our life and say, oh, this is the part where I'm going to do the Christmas thing. And this rest of the time when I'm driving in the car and when I'm dealing with the stress of my family, that's not going to be about how I feel about Christmas. So here are some practical ways that you can try to bring the peace that is the theme of this first week of the season into your life in a real, meaningful way. First of all, you got to recognize if you're going to have peace, you need to become the peace. We aren't looking for somebody else to give us peace other than God, but we're looking for God to bring that peace into our lives through us embodying that peace ourselves. How do I become the light of peace in my own life? First of all, you've got to be determined to be peace and not get stressed out. You've got to decide, how am I going to manage stress? How am I going to avoid overscheduling my life? It's really easy to get overscheduled during the season. There are going to be times when you have to say no. I can't do all of those things. I have to say no to several things every Christmas season where I just recognize I need time to just be at home and pray. I need time to just rest. People are going to be disappointed, but it's okay, because if you show up and you're not the light of peace in that space, you're not doing them a favor by being there at the Christmas party, harried and hurried, and not the best company. So take time to say no and set boundaries. You're not going to be able to please everybody, and just be kind. Show grace to people who don't deserve it. There are a lot of people who are in a bad place during this season, and they're going to be on their worst behavior because they're in a hurry, because they're financially strapped, because they have so many things that they need to do. So offer grace. Be that olive branch of peace that other people need. Smile at people. Tell them it's okay. It's disarming. It takes people out of that place of being angry, and it helps settle them down. You can be a ripple effect that starts with you, that brings peace into the lives around you by simply offering grace when people don't deserve it. In traffic, one of the worst places for peace, but that can be very, very important. Show people that don't seem to deserve it extra grace. And there are other things where you may have had a long time where you've had resentment in your life. Forgive those people, not because they deserve it, but because it's God's job to judge them, not yours. And you can't do a good job getting justice anyway. Let God deal with the justice and let your heart be free. It's not simple, it's not quick, but take the first step of deciding you're going to let your heart be free. This will be a great step this week to start praying on and start meditating on and start letting God soften your heart and let you be free. You can let yourself out of prison by forgiving that person. You're not letting them off the hook. You're letting yourself out of bitterness by not staying angry at them. So let them go into God's hands, and then God can deal with them. If they deserve judgment, God is totally capable of doing that without your help. So trust God to take care of that and let yourself be free. Let God do His job. And just say, I refuse to let that person control me with the bitterness I have toward them. I refuse to let them still have that over me. And let go, be free, and let them be judged by God. Give them grace that they don't deserve. And make sure that you also are reaching out to people in love. Other people around you, when you reach out and you offer peace to people that seem like they're upset, if you really ask people, how are you doing? And we'll talk about that more next week with love, but how are you really doing? That can sometimes take somebody who's really stressed and calm them down. If you smile at somebody just walking around doing your shopping, sometimes that's enough to help bring peace into somebody's life. Offer a sense of humor. A clean joke can help somebody calm down really quick. Humor is an antidote, not sarcasm, because sarcasm is actually hidden bitterness, and that doesn't do as well. That can sometimes be passive aggressive in the way that you present it, so be careful about sarcasm. But otherwise, clean humor can, if you can help somebody laugh, make yourself the butt of the joke, let them laugh about you. But giving somebody something to laugh about can help de-stress. Laughing improves serotonin. It helps relax all your muscles because you're breathing harder, and it changes your mindset. It changes your neurochemistry, actually. So it brings down anxiety and brings peace. Practice other stress management techniques. Do some exercise. Do some short, little, quick, deep relaxation breathing things once in a while, just to keep the stress from getting over on you. And stress will make you get colds faster. So it's actually good to de-stress so that you have better physical health. Because when you get worn down, you're more likely to catch that nasty flu that's going around this year. So be careful to stay in good health. Also, make sure you take time to pray and meditate. Meditate on all the dimensions of peace that Christ offers. He offers us three dimensions of peace that we can't get on our own. Peace with God. We couldn't do that by ourselves. Only Christ can make that happen. Peace within us. We are conflicted people. We have tension and strife within us. We worry. We have anxiety. We have distress. But Christ can bring us that divine peace within ourselves, where we can just feel like, you know what? This is not the best time in my life, but I have hope. So peace can bring us peace with each other as well, a peace that we normally wouldn't have with each other, because we can't forgive each other without His help, and we can't actually have perfect peace with each other without His help. So Christ can make that possible too. So be the peace by meditating on that and praying about that. Make sure that you resist those opportunities to either judge or not judge. It's easy to quickly judge people when you're impatient, if you're in a hurry. So if you can avoid being in a hurry, that's helpful. But also, if you can avoid judging those who are in traffic, or people you don't know, or people who've done something that seems like it's not good character, avoid judging them, because that doesn't help you. It doesn't help you to quickly judge. You can set boundaries that don't put you at risk with those people, but you can also avoid allowing bitterness to creep in and change your attitude to a negative attitude. So do those things that are going to give you some tools to actually put peace in your life. I also listed a ton of scriptures that you can meditate on and pray through during this week of peace. And one of them is Psalm 29:11. The Lord gives strength to His people. The Lord blesses His people with peace. The Lord gives us peace. And that peace, that not being rattled, that not being worried, that is where we are strong. To be able to stand still and be at peace with God, within ourselves, and with each other, makes us strong. And all of the prophecies of Christ talk about the peace that He's going to bring. Isaiah 9, 6, and 7 is one of the most famous prophecies about Christ. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on His shoulders. And He will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of His government and peace, there will be no end. This is an endless eternal peace that we get to look forward to in the kingdom of God as He's coming. And it also says in Isaiah 53:5, He was pierced for our sins. He was the one who was crushed. The punishment that we deserved, Isaiah 53:5 said, brought us peace. That was on Him. He got the punishment and we get the peace. So He made it possible for us to have peace with God by taking all the stuff that we deserve and that He did not deserve, and He took it for us so we can have peace with God. And that peace with God is what gives us peace within us. And the fact that God forgives us and gives us this peace with Him, that's how we are equipped to forgive each other. Because how can we have anything against another person if God has forgiven us for everything by dying for us Himself? I mean, what do we have that's left that makes us higher and mightier than anybody else when God has done that for us, when He's lowered Himself to that? So Christ said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives." This is not a worldly brand of peace. It's an everlasting, supernatural, perfect peace. And so Christ said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." That's not admonishment for people who are afraid. He knew people were afraid at the time that He was on the earth. He knew people were afraid when He was walking toward His own crucifixion, and He knew they would be afraid. But He assured them in this moment, "You don't have to be afraid. I am giving you a peace that will rescue you from any need to really have fear." So we can have this amazing peace that we wouldn't be able to buy anywhere, that we wouldn't be able to learn anywhere else. But we can have it because God gives it to us freely. Isn't that something to celebrate? Whether you have anything else to celebrate or not, take peace with you this week of Advent. And it may not be the time on the calendar where you would normally light the Advent candle for peace, but I felt like it was important to address that, because before we can calm down and celebrate the rest, I think we need to recognize the peace that passes understanding. So I hope you have a really blessed and wonderful week, and I look forward to seeing you next week. Bye-bye.